my former students and tell them.
All right.
Update their notes.
Do we have to take a, what's it called?
No.
No, leave you to get a math scholarship.
No, a homework review, because this is super easy.
Yes, we do. So super easy to do it.
Oh, equals.
Yeah.
5 to the what?
20.
Why is the question?
Because you're multiplying the 5 times 5, the 5 fifths times the 4, but you're just doing that. You know, it's hard to explain, but I know how to do it.
A little bit hard to explain. Nick?
Okay. So basically what you're doing is that there is 5 groups of 5. And then basically you're multiplying them. You're multiplying them by 4, which means you're getting 4 groups of 5 5.
Yes, 4 groups of 5 5.
You have 25.
Yes. You see, I'm color coding this. The 4 is in orange, and these parentheses are in orange because we're multiplying something by itself 4 times. And that's what the orange represents, something by itself 4 times. Now, what are these things that we're multiplying by itself?
5 to the fifth.
5 to the fifth, which means in each parentheses we have, Nick, in each parentheses
we have 5 fives.
We have 5 fives, 5 to the fifth, 5, 5, 5, and 5. And I won't make you watch me draw that many fives, but if I put 5 there, and 5 there, and 5 there, and 5 there, I have 4 groups of 5 fives. How many fives are we multiplying together?
20.
20, 5, 4 times 5, 20 fives. And that is why.
I have a question.
Okay,
go ahead. How come we can't learn about plagues? I want to learn about plagues.
What? Do all the research on plagues you want?
No, in the.
Alright, so let's put everything away except for one piece of paper. Alright, hold on. Let's listen to plagues. It's simple enough, I think. And let's save ourselves some time.
Yeah.
Good going, Grace.
As long as Grace will start and show us why number one is true.
Okay. Well, go up there.
I want you to do whatever you think you can do easily. This or that.
Whoa. Yeah. I thought this was homework review, so we're doing this by ourselves.
No, we're not doing that.
We're gonna save ourselves a little time and some paper. Because you guys seem pretty competent.
Competent.
Can I do one?
No, Ethan.
Where is X?
Yeah.
Guys, seriously.
Really?
Guys, be quiet.
Don't participate. So where do we see this? X to the fifth, where do we see it?
This.
Yes, we do. And that's what X to the fourth is. So to get a good exponent, we're just going to take it
all the way. Guys,
take it all the way.
You're a jerk.
Come on.
Don't let her. No.
Hey.
No.
Hey. Buck-snart.
Buck-snart.
You can move that window.
Foo-foo.
So what did she just show us there with drawing those four parentheses?
That there's four categories of x times x times x.
That's the to the fourth power part. And she's showing us now what he's inside every one of those parentheses, what there are four of. What are there four of?
X times x times x. Or x to the third power.
Four of x times x times x.
Jeez.
X equals
12?
Good job, guys.
Oh!
Yeah!
It's okay.
There are four groups.
Yeah, Edgar.
I accidentally wrote X. Yeah, Gracie.
You did it.
I'm Gracie.
Okay.
No,
it's Grace. So let's move on.
So we all get 10 out of 10 on that?
Sure. You all get 10 out of 10.
Yes. You're welcome.
You're not welcome.
Thank you guys. As long as by the time I'm ready to start, you guys are ready to start as well, which means you guys have notes out. I'm going to write a small note to give you 10 out of 10.
Yeah!
Unless you mess it up here in the next couple seconds.
Uh-oh. Get out your notes.
Don't. That's the first time we've done that again.
Oh, I forgot to talk about this. This is a common error that I see. Okay. Can y'all read this?
Yeah.
In the back?
Yeah. Wait, in the back?
Yeah.
People in the back, can you read it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Barely.
Okay.
First step, not incorrect. It's correct. It's good. I break up the square root of 32 and the square root of 16 is the square root of 2, because 16 times 2 is 32, they're both the square root of 2. Combine them just like that. And then we kind of break off the square root of x to the fourth by itself. But then what goes wrong here? But
square root of 16 is not 4.
It's not the square root of 4. It equals 4, but you don't need the square root around it.
Right. So, kind of get rid of this idea that there's numbers inside of square roots and somehow we're taking them out of square roots. We're not doing that. 4 is just a number that is the answer to what's the square root of 16, right?
Right.
So, for some reason, I'm seeing the square root just written, and you're not the first people to do it, see it every year that we do square roots.
Can I get up a chart?
Square root of 16. Is the number 4?
It's the same
for
the
root.
X squared.
Same as x fourth, x to the fourth, the square root of that is x squared, not the square root of x squared.
Couldn't it be 2 and 2?
Could this be 2?
No.
Oh no, the 2 is okay.
But could I say the same for the square root of 2? The square root of 2 is not a nice number. It's not a, what do we call it, a smooth number.
Yeah,
but
it's not a smooth decimal.
4 can go down to 2, 2.
No. The square root of 16 is what?
4.
Why is 4 the square root of 16?
Because it's 4 times 4.
It's 16. If I were to take that to 2, then I'd be saying the square root of 16 is 2, which is not, because 2 times 2 is 4, not 16.
Yeah.
No more square roots to take, as far as 16 is concerned. Take the square root, it is 4, that part is done. If I take square roots more, then it's not correct.
But can you just...
No, you can't do anything. That's the right way.
Just x4 into, x2.
Okay, we're going to say it correctly. You don't say x4. What do you say?
X to the...
You can even say x to the fourth. You want to be just a little short. X to the fourth. And what do you want to do with that?
Just break it into x to the... x squared.
I think this is what you're saying?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah.
Well,
what's the square root?
Yeah.
So if the square root of x squared would be x, and the other square root of x squared would also be x, multiply those, get x squared, right? So we'd still get x squared. And we would write it like 4x squared times the square root of 2, because it's just more pleasing to the eye. Right? So be careful. When you take the square root of something, you took the square root, there's no longer a square root to take, so don't put square roots around it. Whether you leave it there, or some of you evaluate it again, just keep taking square roots until you... There's no more square roots to take, and then you finally stop. The reason why this is 4 is because we took the square root of 16, and the square root of 16 is 4, and that's it. That's the answer to the question.
That's the answer right there. You can just leave it.
So leave that.
Or you can just leave it as the first one up there.
This one?
No.
Oh,
this one?
Yeah.
Well, why? Because we have to simplify these ones.
Yeah, but without that.
If it were just the square root of 32, then yes.
Well, no, but you can leave that as. Just take out one of those x's and it'll be fine.
Well, we'd have to take out this x. That's the thing. We're not taking them out. We're taking the square root of x squared.
I'm cutting this off.
Oh, well.
You take the square root of x squared, that's x. Take the square root of x squared, that's... Remind me of your passion. You remind me of my middle daughter. You see it on her face. You can tell it's coming. Whatever's in her hand, you better grab it. It's about the joy.
Yeah. So you take off the sign on the x2?
I didn't take it off, no. What we have
he's
is...
timesing the x2.
Because they're
x to the fourth,
together.
The square root of x to the fourth, we can write as
x2.
The square root of x squared times the square root of x squared, just kind of... Separating it like we separated 32 into 16.
And then you simplify it.
That's x, and that's x. So we have x times x.
Oh, okay.
X yeah. If it were just one of those, it would just make square roots.
Okay.
There'd just be x.
You don't mess up, Aaron.
You guys are all messing up, Aaron. You guys are talking too much. Kyle?
So it's pretty much just like x times x, because there's two x's.
This guy here, yeah, this is x, and this is x. X times x, x squared. You got it.
Have you seen Key and Peele? The substitute teacher one?
Yep. When you're a teacher, you see all of those, whatever it is. If it's about teachers, you see it. People send it to you on Facebook.
Teachers, what about
right.
them?
Okay.
They're a D9.
So I'm going to put something up on the board. I want you to see if you can figure out what the simplified version would be. And not only that, But why? That would be the simplified version.
Oh,
okay.
Excuse
and it really
me.
Just takes the amount of effort we've already been putting into these explanations to simplify things, right?
Is there a name of blockade here?
It's funny every time, except for when it's not, like right now. This is too
pretty
long. Let's say x to the 8th over x to the 3rd power. Okay. I want you to simplify that. It can be written as x to the power of something.
Times x.
Not only do I want you to tell me what the answer is, I want you to tell me why. Justify your answer.
What? I don't even know how to do this.
The other one made sense. We had to do
the same. You're smarter than somebody who needs to be told what to do. You got me. Now do what I'm telling you to do.
Got you good. What if you're dividing?
Some of us are going to just fly with this. Some of us are going to do a little more. That help is coming. Okay, just do everything you can think of trying to do. X to the what power?
Fifth.
Okay?
Ah.
X to the fifth. Aiden's correct. It is x to the fifth. I still want, now that you know that, for other people like take a look at it, think like, how did Aiden come up with that? Did Oliver come up with that? Did Clint come up with that?
I just kind of
take a minute.
I just came up with it.
Take a minute. Please take a minute.
I didn't.
Oh, and see if you can come up with an explanation.
Oh, I think I got one. If we can
all
do
hands
more.
Down, the solve is remain calm.
Minus.
I'm remain calm.
And.
Oh.
I got this.
Mm-hmm.
I got it.
Okay.
Do you
guys.
Do you know
what
got it?
You looked in the book
right
here.
I got it.
I got it.
Good right here.
So Grace is disqualified. She cheated.
What?
I did not cheat.
How is that
anyone.
Cheating?
Nice.
Oliver. Tell me how we can prove that this must be.
Dang it!
You must look out the
window. X.
Man, how did you cheat?
Like, I looked in the book.
We're all listening to you, Oliver.
They get like added, but if you minus them, divide them, it's
like opposite. Okay, so that's, you notice that multiplying we add them, so maybe subtracting is what we'd use. But we can justify that further. We can really show that, of course, we would just be able to take the 3 from the 8 and why that is.
I just said.
Well, what I did, I drew like 8 X's, and then I did like 3 X's, and then like under it.
Catch up with the 8 X's. It's 8 X's and 3 X's.
And then I just canceled 1 X on the bottom, and then 1 on top, and then
another one.
Yeah.
Another.
Okay, so let's talk about that. What does that mean, canceling an X?
Three
crossing
out
the
subtract it.
Okay. Crossing out is not a math concept. You don't learn addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and crossing out. What's going on here? What is canceling? Keeping the division sign true.
Yes.
Sign true.
There might be something there, but I'm gonna ask Aiden to get a fresh perspective there. What is going on when we say it's canceling?
Like, x divided by x is 1, and
then
there's 3, so
it's
just like 1 times 1 times the
left. You got it. Here.
Yeah.
So, yes, we have those 8 X's across the top, we got the 3 X's in the bottom, and we say they cancel each other out. Aiden's got it exactly right. Tyler, what did Aiden say?
He said the X times the X.
He don't know.
No, how about give yourself a 90-degree turn to the right, face the board. And listen this time. X divided by X is what?
One.
Just like anything divided by itself is one.
Oh.
X divided by X?
One.
And X divided by X?
One.
So like instead so we have one times one times one, here we have a one times one.
So you're just canceling out the bottom numbers?
So these three get canceled by these three. Like they mutually cancel each other out. The X gets divided by the X, leaving us with a one. And when we multiply by one, nothing happens. And we get another one, and we get another one. And like for every X that's in the denominator, it cancels or divides one of the X's
numerator.
And it does it three times. So in the numerator, we used to have eight, but three of them got canceled. You see where the subtraction comes in? There were eight. Three of them were divided by the three X's in the denominator. And so we have just five of them left to divide. Bridger?
What if you split those around so X8 was on the bottom and X3 was on top? Would
let's do this, do a couple more of these, and then we'll do exactly that.
Okay.
Okay. See, what would X to the 7th over X to the 4th be?
Oh, that's...
Maybe X to the 3rd. Let's see why. Because what? What am I showing you up here?
The canceling out.
The 7 X's that we're multiplying together. What am I going to show you in the denominator?
Four.
Four
X
X's
times X
that
X
are
X.
Being multiplied together. And what happens?
They divide each other.
This guy divides. This is divided by that X. This is divided by that X. This is divided by that X. And we're left with
X3.
Three.
Three X.
We started with 7 in the numerator. Four of them got divided out to one.
Mm-hmm.
And three of them were left. There's our subtraction. Okay? We see the subtraction. Not because the book told us that that's the rule, but because we see that we started with 7, 4 are now divided by another X. They're perfectly matched up. They're canceled out. And we're left with 3 X's to multiply together. Okay. So something like 2 to the 5th over 2 to the 4th, well, it becomes a lot easier. We could do 2 to the 5th, that'd be 32. 2 to the 4th is 16. Then we could actually divide those numbers, or we could just say
1,
2,
3.
2 to the first power, 2 to the 1 power, right? Mm-hmm. 5 minus 4 is 2.
X1.
It
one.
Be
two.
Oh, it's
yeah.
2 1? Oh, because you just plugged in a number for X. Okay.
Sort of. I mean, I made up a new example with numbers.
Or
yeah, I know, but for X, it would have been the same if you did X5 and X4 on the top. It
okay.
would have been X1.
Because if you take 2 by itself, it's just 2.
If you take 2 by itself, it's just 2?
Yeah.
Yeah, 2. There's 1, 2 being multiplied by nothing else. It's just 2, right?
True that.
Okay, 2 to the first is 2. Anything to the first is just itself. Okay, now let's see if we're ready for this.
Uh-oh.
I think we are.
Okay. You see the subtraction rule, right? Can you explain the subtraction rule to somebody who knows even the slightest bit about exponents and division?
Is it subtracting or just canceling out?
Well, it is canceling out.
Right?
But the result is I have this many X's here, this many X's here,
mm-hmm.
this many X's will cancel just as many here, and we'll be left with whatever 7 times 4 is, 3 X's
uh-huh.
all together. So let's see what we think about this. 2 to the 3rd over 2 to the 5th. Let's just straight use the subtraction rule. What do we get?
Negative 2.
2
to
the
negative
power of negative 2. We continue this idea of subtracting exponents when we divide, then this would have to be 2 to the negative 2. This is one of the things that I love about mathematics, is someone comes up with this idea. Like, somebody invented the idea of exponents.
Right.
It's not like it was on a cloud somewhere and they just started using it because that's the way things are supposed to be done. They came up with this idea. And they started messing around with exponents. And they're like, hey, look, if I multiply this many 2s and this many 2s, like, I can just add these exponents together. I can just multiply these exponents together. I can subtract this exponent from that exponent. And then somebody comes along and says, hey, I've been looking at your exponents. I'm trying them out. And remember that subtraction rule you came up with? What the heck does that mean? I just used your subtraction rule, came up with 2 to the negative 2. What does it mean? And the answer is, well, something we can understand. And it's also, it's going to be this thing that we say, because that's the way it would have to be. Okay? Not because it makes a lot of sense based on what we know about exponents right now, like 2 to the negative 2, like negative 2 twos multiplied together, what does that mean? Okay? It's going to be what it's going to mean what it means, because it would have to mean that if I can use the subtraction. If the rules of exponents that we've come up with so far are going to continue to work, then this would have to mean what we're about to look at. And it's not that big a deal, because all we're going to do is the same thing we've done for the past 2 or 3 pages. Write this out the long way. 2 times 2 times 2 over.
So is this just like a different form of doing our last night's homework?
Yeah. So negative exponents, here's what they mean.
Right.
Right? So what happens in this fraction?
You cancel
this 2.
Yeah.
Divided by this 2 is a 1.
And then that 2.
This 2 divided by that 2. This 2 divided by that 2. And so there are 2 twos. There are 2 twos multiplied together, right?
Uh-huh.
But it, like, so 2 to the -2 doesn't mean that they're negative numbers. It doesn't mean, like, take the square root or something. It means that there are 2 twos. It's just there in the denominator. Okay? And now if you think about it, now I kind of get what this might mean to multiply negative 2 twos. It's like doing the opposite of multiplying 2 twos.
Dividing
by 2 twos, right?
1.
Divide by 2 and divide by another 2.
Uh-huh.
Wait, what's the answer then?
1.
Well,
2 divided by 2.
1 over, there's 2 twos left. What's 2 times 2?
4.
So we got a 4 in the denominator, 1/4.
Wait, how do you get the 1 though?
Because that's what's left when I cancel these 2s. I'm left with 1 times 1 times 1, which is 1.
Oh.
And these are all 1s as well. We just don't need to write them. We've got a 1 in the numerator, 1 times 1 times 1 times 2 times 2. Let's ignore the 1s, because multiplying by 1 is a silly redundant thing. So we're just left with, when we simplify it, 1 over 2 times 2. So 2 to the negative 2, what does it mean?
1/4.
It means
1
that there's no 2 squared, it's just in the denominator. There is a 2 squared, it's just in the denominator. So we could have just sat here and taken guesses. Well, maybe it means take the square root, because it's like the opposite of squaring. Okay, maybe that's it. Or maybe it means negative 2 times negative 2. Okay, well, that wouldn't work out very well. But if we write out the long way, we find out it just means 1 over 2 squared. Okay.
Right.
So if I saw 5 to the negative 3, and I wanted to write that with positive exponents and not negative, how would I write it?
Is that a negative? Is that a negative?
1 over 5.
Mm-hmm.
1 over 5
to
the third.
Okay.
Because this could have happened. It could have been the result of this. Just making up an example that could have wound up with a negative 3. Like 5 to the 5th over 5 to the 8th power.
Right.
5 minus 8 would be negative 3. That's how we can come up with a negative 3 from that subtraction rule.
So if you
it just means that these 5 cancel 5 of these, there's 3 left in the denominator to multiply together. 3 left in the denominator to multiply together. Bridger?
So if you wanted to have it 5/3, would you just do 5a over 5/5?
So 5 to the 8th over 5 to the 5th.
Uh-huh.
Yes, now there's fewer in the denominator, more in the numerator. These 5 cancel 5 of those, leaving 3 now in the numerator instead of in the denominator.
And if they're both the same, say 5/5 over 5/5, would you just say 1?
That's a great question. Let's look at that. What would 5 to the 5th over 5 to the 5th be?
1.
Yeah, 5 to the 5th is a number. Forget about how big it is, because this is just as big. 5 to the 5th divided by 5 to the 5th, just like anything divided by anything,
uh-huh,
is 1. But
that's
what would the exponent be?
1.
5. Oh, because, okay, I get it.
If I take 5 to the 8th over 5 to the 5th, 8 minus 5, 3.
Mm-hmm.
If I take 5 to the 5th over 5 to the 8th, 5 minus 8, negative 3, what would this exponent be?
0.
0.
0. So now we learned what some number to a 0 power would have to be. And this is another one of those things where it's some the inventor of exponents is asked, what does it mean if there's a zero in the exponent? I was just thinking about that one day, and I'm asking you now, inventor of exponents, what the heck does it mean if there's a zero in the exponent?
It just means five. Because you don't
have
five?
It means
five?
It means zero.
It's zero?
Well, why would the zero be there if it's not doing any part?
Okay, I got this.
Listen.
Because one means five, so
if it was five,
it would
be zero.
These are all like okay explanations, but here's one that is just like bulletproof. You can't argue that this isn't true. 5 to the 5th definitely is a number divided by itself, which is definitely one.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And this is just one example among many where we could wind up getting a zero exponent, because we have the subtraction thing that we've been talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Take the numerator's exponent, subtract the denominator. Well, if they're the same power, 5 minus 5 would be zero. So what does 5 to the 0 mean? It has to mean
zero.
One. 5 to the 0 has to be one.
So why would you put a zero there? Because if there wasn't a zero, oh wait, never mind.
There are weird things like this.
Five
to the zero power. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense if day one of learning exponents, I just said, okay, let me tell you about exponents. For example, 2 to the 3rd means 2 times 2 times 2. Get it? Multiply 3 of these together, right? We're learning about exponents. And then I just throw up a zero. That does not make sense on day one of exponents, because how do I multiply 0 2s together?
Equals 1.
Sounds like I might get 0. Okay, that's kind of like I could believe it. If you were told on day one of exponents that 2 to the 0 is 0, you would have
believed
it. Hook, line, and sinker. You would have had no reason not to believe it. But day whatever of exponents now, we've learned about exponents for a long time, years now. Here's how we could get a 5 to the 0. Okay, it could be arrived at by doing this, 5 to the 5th over 5 to the 5th. We subtract the exponents, we wind up with a zero exponent. What does that mean? Well, it has to be equal to 5 to the 5th over 5 to the 5th, which we know is equal to 1. It's gotta be 1, because it's a number divided by itself.
But if it didn't have that 0, would it just be 5?
If it didn't have that 0, then, like, if I just write 5, that's understood to be 5 to the 1st. If it isn't there, it's understood to be 1, and 5 to the 1 is 5. Anything to the 1 is itself.
And if it's 0, then that means it's 1.
5 to the 0 is 1. Anything to the 0 is 1. Any number you take to the 0 power is 1. Except there's one number that doesn't apply to.
Yeah.
0. You can't take 0 to the 0 and get 1. Why? Because we can't divide by 0. Let's just thought we were reminded of that. If I tried this explanation with a 0 in there instead of a 5, all of a sudden I'll find myself dividing by 0, which doesn't have a definition. It's undefined.
Have you ever asked Siri what 0 divided by 0 is?
Yeah, cookies and friends.
Yeah.
Like I said, when you're a teacher, you hear all that stuff. Real quick. 6.2. Right. 11, 14, 15, and 17.
What?
Name of friendship.
No.